Большое спасибо всем, кто пришел. Мы очень рады приветствовать здесь профессора Уордского университета Роджера Пенроуза, который будет участвовать в круглом столе под названием «Нужна ли новая физика, чтобы объяснить мозг?». У нас сейчас, давайте я коротко по-русски, прежде чем я перейду на английский, скажу, как все будет устроено. Значит, вся основная часть будет идти по-английски. Сначала каждый из участников, которых я уже представлю сразу после этого короткого введения, сделает небольшое выступление, где-то на 10-12 минут, и после этого профессор Пенроуз это прокомментирует. Это все займет примерно полтора часа, и все будет происходить по-английски. После этого у нас будет небольшой перерыв, минут 10, после чего будет вторая часть, которая начнется с того, что те же участники обменяются репликами небольшими. На это я где-то рассчитываю 30-40 минут, и после этого мы уже будем брать вопросы из зала. И в этой части я могу, те, кому сложно пользоваться английским языком, я смогу что-то перевести. Вот так. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. But again, we are really honored to host here professor of mathematics of Oxford University, Sir Roger Penrose, who will participate in a round table titled Is New Physics Needed to Understand the Mind? And already know that Professor Penrose would going to argue that it is needed indeed. And so I present now all other participants just in alphabet order. So it's member by correspondence of Russian Academy of Science, Konstantin Anokhin from Kurchatov Institute. Then it's a member of Russian Academy of Science, Vladislav Liktorsky from this institute, the Institute of Philosophy. Then Professor Mikhail Mensky from Physical Institute of Academy of Science. Then Professor Alexander Panov from Moscow State University. And Tatiana Chernigovskaya from Kurchatov Institute and St. Petersburg State University. So we'll begin with a short talk, so presented by Alexander Panov. So please, and I just keep the schedule.
Thank you very much. Yes. I would like to say some words about incomputable activity of human brain and about physical foundations of this incomputable activity. Yes. Sorry. Lower. Ближе. Yes. Okay. I start with the Gödel-Turing theorem. The Gödel-Turing theorem states that for any finite-state machine, in other words, usual computer, there is a meaningful proposition that cannot be verified by this machine. The description of structure of a finite-state machine is something very similar to a finite number of axioms of an axiomatic mathematical theory. And the Gödel-Turing theorem is very similar to the well-known Gödel incompleteness theorem about axiomatic systems. I would like to say that there is nothing unexpected or strange in the Gödel-Turing theorem about finite-state machines. At the same time, the Gödel-Turing theorem says nothing about human thinking. However, Sir Roger Penrose proved that the Gödel-Turing theorem actually implicates that for any finite-state machine, the brain of mathematician can do something that this machine cannot do. A human brain carries out some incomputable activity. Therefore, any finite-state machine cannot simulate human intelligence. And human brain is not simply usual classical computer. I would like to call this statement no-go Penrose theorem about artificial intelligence. And I would like to emphasize that it is not the same as the original Gödel-Turing theorem. No-go Penrose theorem is much stronger than Gödel-Turing theorem. A misleading mix of Gödel-Turing theorem and no-go Penrose theorem is rather widespread. But it is absolutely invalid to mix these notions for me. The proof of the theorem is actually very simple and transparent, and everybody can find it in Roger Penrose's books. And I completely agree with this theorem. However, what is the physical origin of incompleteness activity of brain? Roger Penrose argued that any process of classical physics, including classical mechanics, classical field theory, and even classical statistical physics, are computable and cannot be an origin of incomputable activity of brain. I completely agree with these arguments as well. Moreover, Roger Penrose argued also that usual quantum theory, like quantum mechanics, quantum field theory, also is computable theory. Therefore, it cannot be origin of incomputable activity of brain as well. Now, what we have? Obviously, we must search some unknown in computable physics to understand the operation of brain. And this is conclusion of Roger Penrose. I supposed that there is one subtle point in this conclusion. Actually, quantum theory is computable from formal point of view, of course. There are no something incomputable in unitary transformations of vectors of Hilbert space. It is just matrix production, or in other formalism, it may be a solution of linear different equations. But actually, many quantum systems is not computable in our universe in very strong and strict sense. For example, the state of 1,000th qubit quantum computer is represented by 2 to the 1,000th complex amplitudes, complex numbers, and such a large number of information cannot be stored in memory of any classical computer, even if one bit of memory of this computer is located in each Planckian cell of physical space within the whole cosmological event horizon in all visible universe. Such a computer is not simply large or very large. It cannot exist at all in our universe in principle. It is a very fundamental physical restriction. There is a strict cosmological horizon of computations and computability of complex quantum systems is essentially beyond this physical horizon. Complex quantum systems is not computable from the physical point of view. The quantum brain should be, of course, a very complicated quantum system, it is clear. And this complex quantum system is not computable in the sense of cosmological horizon of computations. Therefore, from a physical point of view, of an observer located in our universe, quantum evolution of brain should be considered as strictly incomputable in the sense of cosmological horizon of computability. May it be that such sort of incomputability is exactly the incomputability predicted by the no-go Penrose theorem about artificial intelligence. From the point of view of pure mathematics, it is not the case, obviously. Pure mathematics does not support the notion of cosmological horizon of computations. But human brain is not a mathematical object. We deal with a physical system, and we must adopt a physical point of view to computability of the activity of brain. Which point of view is valid, pure mathematical or physical? I'm not sure, I don't know. But my opinion is that usual quantum physics as possible origin of incomputable activity of brain is not ruled out yet. But some new incomputable physics is not excluded as well, of course. Thank you very much.
It is an honor for me to participate in this seminar or round table. Very important remark which I can give is that what is the meaning of the word consciousness, which I will use in my talk. This is the most fundamental level of consciousness, namely distinction between something subjected to consciousness or not subjected to consciousness. This is not processes which can be performed on the background of consciousness. This is very important because most often consciousness is meant as processes in consciousness, but not for me. Now the question. Very hard question. What is consciousness as such? What is this fundamental level of consciousness? There is no clear answer to this question. And I hope, and many people hope, that quantum mechanics can help to answer this important and very difficult question. So, a small history of relation between quantum mechanics and consciousness. The history began by works of Pauli and Jung, psychologist and physicist. They worked on the strange phenomenon of synchronicities and hoped to explain it by quantum mechanics. Nowadays, the topic of consciousness and quantum mechanics was strongly supported by Sir Roger Penrose. And in the as a starting point of this of consideration of Penrose was the phenomenon of intuition. This topic, quantum mechanics and consciousness, is very important in many reasons. First of all, it concerns the deepest aspects of reality. This concerns human perception and mysterious conception, mysterious phenomena of life. This phenomenon of what is intuition? Penrose started from the from some evidences of great scientists that the most important achievements of them was connected with spontaneous and unexpected insights, which came seemingly nowhere. It is not clear what is the origin of these events, these insights. And I shall try to explain how quantum mechanics can make this question more clear. This will be done on the basis of so-called Everett's interpretation of quantum mechanics, and the quantum concept of consciousness will be elaborated as extended Everett concept. So, the main point of Everett interpretation is that different classical realities coexist. They coexist in the form of superposition, quantum superposition of quantum states of the world. There are different verbal formulations of this statement, but I consider that most most convenient is a formulation that alternative classical realities objectively coexist, but they are only classical projections of quantum mechanics, and they these projections are separated between each other in consciousness. In consciousness helps to separate these alternatives, so that each one is seems to be a single one. And now let's make a small step. Instead, the statement alternatives are separated in consciousness, we shall accept another formulation. Consciousness is identical to separation of the alternatives. Seemingly small step, but it has many interesting consequences. And this is the main point of the extended Everett concept, which I suggested in 2000. Yeah. So the more detailed formulation of this main point is consciousness is an ability to perceive the objectively coexisting alternatives separately from each other. This is, in a sense, definition of consciousness. But consciousness in that meaning which I mentioned earlier. Then logically follows from this definition some new phenomenon which can be called superconsciousness. So if consciousness is separation of the alternatives, then what is no consciousness? And no consciousness mean sleeping, trance, or meditation. What is no consciousness? If consciousness is separation of the alternatives, then no consciousness means that there is no separation between alternatives. They are all together. We have some nature access to all alternatives together. Consequences which follow from this is, first, access to all alternatives In all times, really in all times, I can't prove this immediately, but this follows from deterministic evolution in quantum mechanics. Then, if we have, put part of the information obtained in this great database, all alternatives together, if bring part of this information into consciousness in the usual state of mind when it is conscious, then we have origin for super intuition. So the insights which have no ground in all information we have in our conscious state. So we don't understand what is the origin of these insights, but really it is in quantum reality as a whole, not separated. And in fact, this conclusion is confirmed by human experience. It is confirmed by religions, great religions, by Oriental philosophies, and by deep psychological practices. This is an illustration of what I have said. If we have, according to Everett interpretation, generally, the state of the world is the superposition of several or many or infinite number of alternative classical reality. So, but if we have consciousness, then these alternatives are separated. So they are perceived independently from each other, and illusion arises that there is only one, only a single alternative. But if consciousness is weakened, then this separation is weakened. And when we perceive one of the alternatives, then we have also some access to other alternatives. Okay, so concluded, consciousness logically follows from quantum mechanics. It is confirmed by psychological experience. It belongs both spheres of matter and sphere of spirit. What I have said, what I have overlooked shortly, briefly, is not reduction to physics, consciousness to physics, but a sort of psychophysical parallelism. Brain is an interface between consciousness and body, and consciousness is not physical conception in this context. But it can be shown that first steps can become this conception, consciousness, closer to physics. But for this, we need the whole world, we need to consider the whole world as one of the physical systems. This is close to the notion of microcosm, but this maybe includes quantum gravity, some ideas of quantum gravity, and this is again parallel to ideas of Penrose. Okay, and generalization of all this is possible from consciousness to life as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I would like to say that the bubble of consciousness is now being studied in multi-disciplinary perspective by many special sciences, including cognitive sciences, neurosciences, and maybe physics, in particular quantum mechanics. And so there are a lot of many new ideas, and I think that in this context, the book by Professor Penrose is very interesting, very stimulating. But I would like to draw your attention to the fact that the problem of consciousness was studied, was discussed for many, many centuries in philosophy. And I think that in philosophy, some very peculiar features of this phenomenon were formulated, were selected, and philosophers continue to participate in these discussions now, and I think that the main problem which is connected with this participation of philosophers in this discussion about the possibility of studying consciousness is as follows. It is not only a problem of what can physics, in particular quantum mechanics, to do for brain sciences. It is a very important problem. But there is another problem. This problem is what can it do? What are our understanding of the very phenomenon of consciousness? It's possible also to formulate this problem in such a way. Can consciousness be a subject of scientific study in general? Because it's a very peculiar phenomenon. You see, it's very distinct from all other phenomena which are object of our usual knowledge and of all sciences also. Because, for example, consciousness have such very, very specific features as follows. Everybody know about her or his own consciousness, about the states of his consciousness, about the essential objects of his consciousness, about what to have consciousness or to lose consciousness, about such phenomena as attention, as intention, as volition. It's possible to make free choices and to make deeds. How is it possible? It is very, 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 very strange. It is impossible to be. It is every act of consciousness has its bearer, which is called self or ego. Yeah? It is impossible to be mistaken about your own ego or self. You can be mistaken about intentional objects of yourself, including such cases when you are intentional objects of your own. But it is impossible to misidentify the theory of the subjects of all these intentional acts. So this very strange phenomenon. You have so-called perspective for the first person, because all kinds of knowledge usually are obtained from the perspective of the third person. But in the case of consciousness, you have a perspective from the first person. So when a student heard lectures on philosophy, and after one of the lectures he came to a professor, he asked the professor, "You see, sometimes it seems to me that I don't exist." "But to whom it seems?" Professor asked. "To me, therefore you exist." So it is a very peculiar so-called position from the first person. So the problem is, how it is possible to study in scientific manner this so-called position from the first person. Is it possible in principle? Maybe consciousness is not subject from scientific studies in distinction from all other subjects. So it is so-called hard problems of consciousness, because consciousness have some phenomenal qualities, so-called qualia. Is it possible to explain qualia from scientific point of view? So some authors, you know them, they're very popular now, not in abroad, but in my country also, think that the so-called hard problems of consciousness cannot be studied in usual scientific manner. So this is to suppose that consciousness exists primordially. It has roots in the epoch of the universe. So, so-called some psychic conceptions, which seem until recently outfashioned, have become popular again. And I think I don't share this position because I think it is possible to investigate or study consciousness from a scientific point of view. But I think that in this connection, this taken into consideration, all in fact, the functions of the functioning of consciousness is impossible without brain activities. And maybe from the back understanding of these brain activities, the functions of brain, it is necessary, maybe it is fruitful to take into account some new approaches in quantum mechanics also, but it can explain something, but the brain activities is a necessary condition from the existence of consciousness, but as to the nature of consciousness, the norm means, I think it is possible to understand them if you take into account also that it can be understood in the formal point of view, the framework of representational theory of consciousness. It is connected with information, understanding of consciousness states and events. And I think that I can to show it, but now that it is possible to show that so-called qualia can be understood in the framework of this approach. It is possible to show how it is possible to have so-called the position from the first perspective. It is possible from the position of the first perspective to show how this position of the first perspective arises, how it is possible. So I think that it is connected with the idea that so it is necessary to take into account in other way the relations between a cognizing being, it can be a human being, but not only human being, but other living being also. It is possible to take into account the relations, not only between conscious phenomena, but also between this cognizing being and the world. This relations between organism, its brain, and its relations with the world, information relations and activity relations, because they are interconnected. In this relation, it's possible to show also that the so-called the obtaining of information from the world is connected with the information from the cognizant being itself also. Interdependent between these two ways of information. And I think it is also very important now, and there are corresponding researchers in this field, to take into account also that knowledge and consciousness can exist not only in conceptual and categorized forms, as it is usually, but also in non-conceptual. I think if you take into account this approach, I think it is possible to say that consciousness and self-consciousness presuppose each other, and that some kinds of Non perception consciousness can be non-living human emancipation, but among other living things also. So I think that it is possible to practice scientific approach to the phenomenon of consciousness, they are very, very complicated. And I think that the different types of disciplines, such as different cognitive sciences, brain sciences, neurosciences, maybe physics also, can contribute a lot to this very, very hard problem. It is hard problem, but from my point of view, it is not unexplainable, and I think that it is possible to understand consciousness not to, without using a hypothesis about psychism and about the impossibility to scientifically understand this phenomenon. So, for my point of view, it is a challenge to science, to many sciences, which is dealing now with human beings, consciousness, in some new station in the world of science, and maybe quantum mechanics can contribute to this research also. But it is not very clear for me how it is possible to explain, to understand such specific features of consciousness about which I said with the help of the ideas of quantum mechanics. Thank you.
So our next speaker is Professor Chimingu.
Is it functioning?
Yes.
So my short talk will be very close to what Professor Liptovsky said. But I'll try to make it more or less structured. I would say that the main problem, we have two main problems. One is the definition of consciousness. Dramatic controversy in the results that different sciences give us is probably about that. We have no consensus on what we understand when we pronounce any term, whether it's consciousness or mind or awareness or reflexivity or being awake, and it's not the whole list. So I would say that till the time when we stop somewhere, we shall get all these controversial results and approaches. The other problem that I see is can there be experimental verifications of thought experiments, even theoretically? Can we get experimental evidence that prove this or that hypothesis to be true? I do not know the result of it. So Roger brings consciousness into physics, and he has opponents from philosophers like David Chalmers, who argues against quantum consciousness, and up to physicists like Max Tegmark and some others who say that cold numbers unmake quantum mind. We have no time to discuss it now, but it's about the temperature of the mind and the speed of neural processes that do not cope with quantum world. What troubles me in this connection is the problem of free will, because the problem of causality is there. It's a metaphor to compare quantum events and what is going on in microtubules. then it's okay. But if it's a real physical comparison, then I feel kind of nervous. And my question is whether it can be proved. Do we really have any evidence about superpositions in a quantum sense of events that occur in microtubules? Do we have evidence, or we are just telling the story? Then, backward time effects in the brain that come from this position are very troubling, I would say. Again, do we have any evidence of backward time effects? If there are such, then there is causal paradox, don't they? And we cannot simply pass it. It's a serious point. So, if we look at Buddhist descriptions of consciousness, we read there something like that consciousness is the sequence of discrete events. So I mean that I hint on the fact that there are different traditions describing consciousness, even in theoretical strata. And being at the Institute of Philosophy, I want to stress, and it's not politeness, I'm absolutely serious, that the main player here is an analytical philosopher. I'm absolutely sure that if an analytical philosopher is not involved, we can get tons and tons and billions of facts, and we won't know what to do with it. And of course, the problem of qualia and of first-person experience are very difficult. Probably my friend and colleague, Professor Anokhin, will tell us. But I simply can't imagine how can we study this in the paradigm of natural sciences. How can we get this information about first-person experience? And the question that is connected with this is whether consciousness or mind is human-specific, or it is spread all over the universe. There is pre-consciousness, there are some variants of consciousness in all the living beings. And again, we come to my first word. It's all about definition. We should settle it. We should agree at some point. We have some weak or strong, probably weak, consensus about what we are talking about. When I give lectures to my students at St. Petersburg State University, I often tell them, if a magician comes and tells me, I'll give you what you want, let's go to the Institute of Human Brain, with whom I cooperate every day, and we shall show you whatever you ask for. And then it all stops, because I do not know what to ask for. Because whatever they show me, I can say, it was attention, this was memory, these were associations, these were just reflections of some kind, etc., etc., etc. So, and again, the huge arguing, the everlasting discussion about whether consciousness is human-specific will never, ever last till we give these definitions. Because if it's about reflexivity, then it's more or less human. And again, we do not know, because we do not have first-person experience from cats and wolves and monkeys. We simply do not know. If to recall a very famous, years ago, theoretical biologist von Uexküll, he invented a term which is Umwelt. So his main idea was that any human, not human, any living being has its or his or hers Umwelt. So a separate world which is not transparent to any others. And so, again, it's about what we mean when we say consciousness or mind. When I was listening to all my colleagues, I was thinking, is it consciousness that they are talking about? Probably it's mind, or being awake and not sleeping. You were talking about sleep, but are you sure that there is no consciousness in sleep? I'm not. Because it's a very... Yes, so definitely not zero. Yes, do you agree? So, I think I should stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I would like to say six things. First, I think that it is very good and it is very important that we are here. Despite probably we do not understand each other and speak different languages, it is even more important, and there is more reason that we came together. Because second, consciousness today is one of the major unsolved problems in science. And I will stress in science, not in philosophy. By stressing this, I mean that there are reasons to believe that it is open to scientific investigation. Obviously, consciousness is the greatest unsolved problem in biology, something which we do not know in biology, comparable to other biological phenomena. Probably it is one of the greatest problems in modern science at all. My third comment, that consciousness is obviously a very complex aspect problem, which explains many things that we discussed here together. We probably do not have yet a proper way to speak and to think about consciousness. Daniel Dennett mentioned some years ago that consciousness is probably one of the greatest remaining mysteries in our knowledge. By mystery, meaning something about which we do not know how to think yet. And other people like Susan Blakemore stress that if you think that you have a solution to the problem of consciousness, this is probably because you do not understand yet the problem. It is extremely difficult. And one of the difficulties is that because we do not hold in mind all the ingredients for the solution of this problem. Consciousness is studied by philosophy for many centuries, and there are specific philosophical problems. As a biologist and neuroscientist, people who also study consciousness and having some experience in psychology, I can say that, for example, neuroscientists studying the brain very randomly think and pose the questions and design the experiments to specifically address the problems of consciousness, especially at the deep level touched by philosophy. So people studying neurons and microtubules randomly speak about brain and mind problems, while philosophers do not know the exact details of the neuronal processes in the brain. And physicists probably, being acquainted with physics and mathematics, do not know all the layers of the psychology, neuroscience, which are related to this problem. Therefore, I said that one of the important things, most important things which we can do is to start speak together and to be open to different hypotheses and solutions to the problem. I think it is prerequisite at the moment to exclude any particular solution, though, of course, the critical method of science is necessary. What I think is necessary also is to start to build the requirements from different disciplines to the scientific theory, because our understanding of consciousness can come from theory. Theory should be one that predicts and explains observable phenomena, both in subjective reality, behavior, and biology and neuroscience. The fourth thing which I wanted to mention is that we do not have many good theories at the moment, ones that would be conforming requirements from different disciplines. For example, in neuroscience, which leads at the moment the way for study, scientific study of consciousness, and claims the scientific approach to it. Most of the theories of consciousness which we have now are descriptive. By this I mean that these theories are trying to explain what happens in the brain when consciousness exists and how it is different from when consciousness is not existing, but it is not addressing the main problems of how the subjective experience can arise and what is necessary for this from the activity of the brain. So we need prescriptive theories, fundamental theories of what consciousness is, but not simply descriptive. Second thing which we need for the theories of consciousness, we need the theories which will be universal for different systems where we observe or expect to observe consciousness. For example, theories which describe conscious processes in terms of the cortical activity and integration in cortex probably are not very good for describing subjective experience which we know from other species, like birds, for example, crows, or octopuses, which have completely different nervous systems. But various accumulating evidence suggests that they bear the subjective phenomena. So we need a fundamental theory which will be void of the particular description of brain structures characteristic to one or other type of species. Only this theory can probably answer them in fundamental way the questions how should consciousness look like if it is existing or it should exist, will be predicted to exist in some extraterrestrial organisms which like neurons or microtubules in neurons. Are microtubules and neurons especially prerequisite for the emergence of consciousness, or it can exist on different substrates? Is it possible to generate consciousness in artificial systems? And if yes, do we need to build neurons and microtubules in them? Final thing, in terms of such fundamental problems to which theory should look and build the explanations with the prediction into experimental observable domains. I do not think personally, but this is my personal opinion. I do not think personally, first, that we need at the beginning of this to have a proper definition of consciousness. I rather think that we should start with what we have and work out step by step, pragmatically using one or other approach or definition which we have in mind, because I, as other people also holding the same opinion, think that our proper understanding of consciousness and definition will come only when we will have a proper theory. So the understanding and definition is a result of having a theory. While we are beginning just to build a theory and start to think of the problem of consciousness, we can do it with a vague definition. This is not a problem in the human understanding. It can build step by step with the pragmatic discussions of what we need. I also do not think personally that problem of non-computability of our consciousness and conscious understanding is the main problem the theory should address. First, because insights and creativity, which is non-computational, the one which, for example, Einstein was describing, saying that the complex theories are not the result of any logical induction coming from facts. They are impulses of such creative things. They are also often not conscious. They are coming to consciousness and being consciously reconstructed there, but they are created not at the conscious level. So it's not the direct problem for related to consciousness. And second, that the initial premise that the logical operations characteristic to computers are not possible to produce, are not capable to produce this understanding is a correct one. And I think most of the people who study brain now, comparable to, let's say, 20, 30 years ago, absolutely do not think that brain is using the existing computer logical system. But this doesn't mean at the moment that we need a quantum physics approach to describe the origin of this complex phenomenon. To my point of view, the main problem of consciousness, which should be addressed scientifically, is how brains are making very complex things, like concepts of music, flowers, colors, Eiffel Tower, clouds, paintings, which are the result of the activity of many millions of neurons organized in networks of networks and networks. And this biological complexity, which brings to this specific conscious state and the quality of consciousness, I think is the major thing which we are missing. Whether it is modulated by quantum processes, during oscillations, 40 Hertz oscillations in neurons involved in these ensembles, could be, yes. And it is at least worthwhile examining. But I think that the main problem for the consciousness is the formation of this complexity.
Short questions, if you allow me. The first question is, if you go to the woods to search for mushrooms, shouldn't you know how they look? Any chance to find any mushroom? Because you do not know what is mushroom.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Then the second question is, any chance to renew extraterrestrial, the other kind of mind.
Let me those questions stop and we just...
Yeah, I will answer probably both questions later on. Yes,
yes, yes, yes, sure. That's what I suggest. So, now please, Roger.
Okay. Well, it's a very great pleasure for me to be here and to be able to take part in this discussion. And I wasn't quite sure what I would be saying, partly depending upon what other people said. Perhaps I should make a few comments about my own view, which relate perhaps to things people have said earlier. In the first place, the things that I've been addressing in the history of consciousness have been very limited in the sense that I've concentrated merely on the issue of understanding and the issue of understanding in the context of mathematics. Now you may say there's a very small area of consciousness, and indeed it is, mainly because almost all the other areas of consciousness are things which I have nothing to say whatsoever except that I don't understand them. So if we ask what pain is or what the qualia of various kinds, such as the perception of the color red and so on, I have virtually nothing, certainly nothing original to say on these issues. Whereas if I think about what's involved in understanding mathematics, I think there is something which one can say about it. It doesn't mean, of course, that I think those are the most important problems in consciousness. I certainly do not. These questions don't tell us very much at all about what awareness is, what consciousness is. When I say the word awareness, by the way, I mean the passive aspect of consciousness. I might talk about free will or something when I'm talking about the active aspect. Understanding itself is somewhere between, because it involves being aware of things and also of making decisions one kind or another. So I think that's somewhere in between the active and the passive aspects of consciousness. Now, yes, let me just make a few comments about my own views, perhaps, and then maybe I will address a few things that people have said, but I think there were too many of them to say much here. I certainly believe that consciousness is functional, and it's not what people refer to as an epiphenomenon. It's actually doing something. I find it very hard to see why such a curious phenomenon would have evolved in beings if it wasn't actually useful to the beings. And I think there are many arguments of that sort which suggest that it is really doing something which either you couldn't do without it or else which you couldn't do as effectively without it. So I think consciousness has a functional aspect to it. However, I do not think that we're in a good position to define it at the moment, so I would take the view that trying to make a definition of consciousness is premature, and that we have some feeling, all of us, something about what it means, but we don't necessarily want to define it. So I think that defining it, we probably would certainly get it wrong. So it's a little premature, until we have a better theory of what's really going on. I do, however, believe that consciousness is scientifically accessible. It's something which can be addressed by scientific method, and certainly I hope that there are experiments of various kinds, which I think already there are, but more specific ones which may give better insight into what consciousness is. As I've certainly said in my books, I think it is a non-computational thing. I should make one point, which may be a point you made earlier, about quantum devices may be doing things which are far beyond what a classical computer could do, and I agree with that. there is something that involves in the complexity of quantum systems, because there is an exponential character. The more individual ingredients you have, the number of different states goes up exponentially in the number of these ingredients, which is different from what happens with classical computers. So that if you wanted to simulate a quantum device classically, you would have to have an absolutely vast one, which is out of the question. However, you might be able to simulate a quantum system by a quantum computer, and that's still a computer in the sense of being a computational entity. So I think that the arguments that I try to make to say that our conscious understanding is not something of a computational character would apply equally to quantum computing systems as to classical ones. So I'm not sure I see the distinction, apart from the fact that they would have to be, if they were classical, they would have to be enormous, and I agree, but why not have them quantum devices? The claim that I'm trying to make here is not that quantum mechanics has to be going on in consciousness. See, my claim is much more outrageous than that. I'm saying that it's not quantum mechanics that we need, it's that what goes beyond quantum mechanics. And that the arguments that I try to make are that there is something needed which goes beyond quantum mechanics. In fact, I would say that the topic of this discussion, I don't think people have quite addressed, perhaps you did, implicitly, the question is whether we need something beyond our current physics, and our current physics involves quantum mechanics. So if it's just quantum mechanics that's going on in the brain to provide consciousness, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that we need something beyond quantum mechanics. Now, this might seem outrageous, but my experience in trying to understand quantum mechanics leads me to believe that quantum mechanics, as we presently have that theory, cannot be the right answer to what's going on. I would, in fact, in a sense, agree with at least three of the main proponents or originators of quantum mechanics: Einstein, Schrödinger, and in fact Dirac, all of whom made comments that quantum mechanics was an incomplete theory. I would say not just incomplete, it's strictly speaking inconsistent. You have one procedure in quantum mechanics, which is unitary evolution, which basically means the following of the Schrödinger equation, which is a deterministic system. And then there's the other procedure, which is what is done in making a measurement. The Schrödinger equation, as Schrödinger himself pointed out, does not give us what the real world does. This was why he introduced his famous cat thought experiment, because he was saying, if you do a quantum experiment and if you treat the cat as a quantum system in the standard way, you get nonsense. In other words, you get dead and live cats simultaneously. Now, there's a common view, I don't think it was Schrödinger's, but there's a common view certainly expressed by a number of quantum physicists, particularly Wigner and, I believe, von Neumann, where they took the view that the quantum evolution satisfied the Schrödinger equation, if you like, up until a point at which a conscious observer was involved. Now, I do not take that view. My view is that the change that has to be made in quantum mechanics has to be understood at a purely physical level. There is something out there which does not require conscious observers and which reduces the state in the case of the cat, dead or alive. Well, I think the cat is not a very good example in a sense, because the cat I would regard as a conscious object, and so that is it allowed to observe itself? I'm not quite sure how that comes into this Schrödinger cat example. I prefer to consider examples where you have an inanimate object which is a superposition of being in one place or another, and the question is, does that superposition, where according to standard quantum Schrödinger evolution, that object could be simultaneously in one position and in another position, the argument would be that such a state would be unstable and would spontaneously become one or the other. And my view is that that involves something outside present-day quantum mechanics, that one can make certain specific estimates as to how big a superposition between one thing and another would have, how big it would have to be before it would spontaneously become one or the other. And the argument is that whatever is going on in that process has to be something both outside present physics, that's new physics, also physics which is subject to experiments. There are people at the moment who are trying to do experiments to see whether this sort of level at which one expects a superposition of two things to become one or the other. Okay, well, maybe that will tell us something about that. But I'm claiming that that has to be where some non-computational process takes place. And so this means that the brain has to be taking advantage of that, if this idea is correct, and that the, for many reasons, one can see that neurons themselves would not be able to probe this level. However, something at a deeper level of structure, and the best bet that I've ever seen is the one put forward to me by Stuart Hameroff, which is that microtubules are likely to be the major contributor to the where the state could be a superposition of one thing or another, and the reduction to one thing or the other rather than superposition would be crucial to the organization of probably the strength of the synapses and so on, and this would the neuron structure would be basically computational, but it would be changing all the time, being subject to plasticity in synapses, which would be, at least to some degree, under the control of a deeper level where coherent systems of microtubules would be responsible. So that's the general idea. Just to comment on a few other points people made, I certainly don't think that consciousness is necessarily in humans. I think I mentioned that. How far down in the system of animals, I have no idea. I've always been a little bit suspicious of insects because they don't seem to be conscious in the sense that I like to think of them as being, but maybe they are. Octopuses and crows were mentioned earlier. I'm quite prepared to believe that they have a serious degree of consciousness. what else was I going to say? Oh yes, also when you're asleep, well certainly when you're dreaming, I think there is an element of consciousness that it seems to me I'm certainly aware of something in the dream. It's not necessarily a real external event that one's aware of, but it seems to me that there is a consciousness involved in that.
I think perhaps that's all I'll say at the moment. Do you have any questions?
Thank you very much. Actually, we started our meeting a bit late, but now we are going to be here to schedule. So, actually, what I suggest, we make this discussion between participants now, and then probably we make a short course before taking general discussion. Okay? And I suggest, as a kind of rule, that each speaker just keeps a 3-4 minutes limit for just one breath length to exchange the reference. Я по-русски повторю, мы сделаем тогда сейчас вот обмен между участниками, репликами, потом маленький перерыв и дальше уже общую дискуссию.
Было бы неплохо, если бы переводили.
Татьяна had two questions. First, how can we find consciousness if we do not know how it looks like? How we can find Martianism if we don't know how that looks like? And this is of course a classical question starting from Plato. How we find the truth if we do not know ahead how it looks like? I think there are ways for the science to do it separately. I don't think that we need logical a priori knowledge of how it looks like in order to proceed scientifically. And second question was about extraterrestrial intelligence and consciousness. How can we recognize it? When I mentioned extraterrestrial consciousness, I meant, can we imagine how this system with consciousness, but without neurons and microtubules, should look like? So it was a theoretical question. But if to speak practically, how can we recognize whether a particular system is consciousness without direct access to its own subjective role. I can suggest, depending on how these extraterrestrials will look like, a number of tests which I use, for example, whether they will recognize themselves if they have vision in the mirror. For example, they do not have vision. Whether by their behavior they are able to answer what is known in the tests for animal consciousness and episodic memory as unexpected questions, something which is not derived directly from the current activity, but is a part of a previous episode experience which were not related to this activity. So whether they can bring one knowledge to solve the problem in the other domain, and knowledge of episodic memory. So I think that there are approaches to have empirical criteria of conscious objects or systems without direct access to the subject.
I would like to, yes, I would like to not put a question, but to make a reply to Tatiana Vladimirovna. I think it is a very interesting problem which was discussed by Tatiana Vladimirovna, opening out so-called movements, different images of reality, different kinds of perception, different living beings. That's very interesting. But I think that it is, for example, from our point of view, from the point of view of human beings, it is impossible to feel as a butterfly, for example, or a bat. There is a very famous article by American philosopher Thomas Nagy. What it's to be, what it's like to be a bat. It's impossible to feel as a bat. But nevertheless, we can understand, you can explain modes of perception which exist with a bat. Because we know that bats have no eyes, have no visual perception, but they can give information about their outer world with the help of sonar. So we can depict a picture of the world from the point of view of bats. For example, recently I saw several pictures about how a butterfly, how an eagle, and how a human being see the same reality. It is possible. You can understand. You can feel like a bat. We can't have the same qualia as a bat has, but we can understand their modes of perception. But as to extraterrestrial, I think that, but it is interesting that we can understand that, we can understand the shark. For example, some types of shark can perceive electromagnetic waves. So they view of the world will be very clear, but we can understand it. But a bat and the shark cannot understand us, human beings, yes? But I think as to the extraterrestrial, maybe if these extraterrestrial beings have an intellect, reason more powerful than ours, than humans, maybe it is impossible for us to understand them. Maybe their picture of reality will be another than ours. But they, if they are more developed in intellectual sense than we, maybe they can understand us. So it is very interesting problem. So I think that there is no infinite, this different images of reality are not impenetrable. We can understand some of them, but not all of this. This circumstance does not exclude the fact that we have that all of us deal with the reality, but we extract different structures from the different levels of reality. But I think so. What do you think about it?
I agree.
And then
we
have.
Not transferable,
then it's a disaster, so we still
have
some chance.
Okay, I suggest through the Roger, maybe Tatiana, Mikhail
Alex. Well, just to address the question I think you put, could you have consciousness without neurons or microtubules? Well, certainly according to my view, it's not specific to neurons or microtubules, it's just that those would be the things that are playing a big role in our own brains. And so microtubules, if they are to be relevant to consciousness in the scheme I'm proposing, they would have to have certain characteristics that they can preserve quantum coherence at a level which is, they'd have to be many, many microtubules if it's microtubules, at a level which just probes the region where quantum mechanics needs to be changed. So it's nothing to do with them actually specifically being microtubules, it's just that microtubules, according to this scheme, would have to have very special physical properties where they probe the new part of physics that we need. What's particularly interesting here, as from the point of view of looking at this as a scientific project, it will tell you that microtubules have to have very peculiar quantum mechanical properties. And there are actually some very recent experimental results done by Anirban Bandyopadhyay and his colleagues in Japan, where they do seem to find extraordinary properties in individual microtubules. These are pig brain microtubules, and they find things like very specific frequencies, they become highly conductive, and in a way which is very curious, not like ordinary substances, they become conductive where the resistance is independent of the length. Well, in fact, it goes down. The longer the microtubule is, the more conducting they are. Moreover, they seem to be, at least over a broad range of temperatures, independent of the temperature. And that temperature includes body temperature. So these are very remarkable new results, which have only just, I think just a couple of them, papers on this, just now being accepted for publication, so it's very new.
Can you relate these properties of conductance, at least in the way you're interested in them politically, to the activity of neurons, why they are important and how this translates to the overall activity?
I don't think these experiments say very much about that. They're just individual microtubules. So you have experiments where they measure resistance. You put a voltage in at very specific frequencies and then you measure the resistance.
But supposedly they are in the neurons and they still have these properties. How would they be important, do you think? Why?
It would be, well, first of all, they would have to have some influence on presumably the expression of synapses. I mean, I can't think of anything else which would be important enough to control the way the brain operates. But if they control, if they at least in a coherent way influence the strength of synapses, then yes, that could strongly affect how a being behaves. So that would be the idea. Of course, that's a separate question. The microtubules themselves, it's probably through actin or something like that, because they don't actually go directly up the... there are presumably other substances as well. I don't think the microtubules are the only things involved in this, but they could be the major, according to the scheme. But you need to have lots of them in order to reach the level at which the quantum coherence would spontaneously reduce, according to the scheme. I should say that is a scheme where you use general principles of Einstein's general theory of relativity and of quantum mechanics. To call it quantum gravity is a bit misleading. It's not really quantum gravity, but it's more like gravitational quantum mechanics, where you're looking at the principles underlying Einstein's theory, which involve certain very fundamental principles, which are somewhat at odds with the principles of quantum mechanics. And the idea is that this tells you that those principles of quantum mechanics cannot be completely right at all levels. And that's what you're using. You're not using quantum gravity in the sense that other people might, which is a completely different scale of the phenomenon.
Thank you, now you pay. Okay. So, the discussion shows that consciousness has to make sort of meaning different for other authors. So, we have to be very careful with defining what we are talking about. So I shall answer one concrete question of Professor Chernyko. Your question, sorry, your question. You pose maybe a question that in Silicon consciousness is not transformed completely. Of course, I only for simplicity, I consider two states completely turned on and completely turned off consciousness. But of course, experience of some yogi, for example, shows that super consciousness can be used even on the ground of completely turned on consciousness. So this is not contradiction. The very important what I what concerns to my talk is that this is not proof. I show only that quantum mechanics hints us what can be done, but we have to work for complete this problem, and maybe this will be going beyond the quantum mechanics in the modern form. At least what I see very clearly that we have to seriously speak about quantum coherent work of consciousness, and not in the in the restriction of some specific system, for example, microtubules or something else, but wider. So, quantum coherent level of description of how consciousness works. Not consciousness, super consciousness. And consciousness in usual sense is of course feature of some restricted systems. For example, brain as a whole or microtubules doesn't matter. Okay, the general remark is that the discussion shows that there are many aspects of consciousness, problem of consciousness, which should be investigated further. We are at the beginning of this problem, of this scientific problem. And of course, there's different views of this problem do not contradict each other in this stage, but may help to each other. What should be an idea?
I would like to add some words about quantum states and quantum evolution in microtubules. There is. It may be seem strange that quantum states may exist at room temperature, of course. But actually, there are examples of large macromolecules that really exist in complicated quantum states at room temperature in liquid or in solid states. One such example is, I don't know what the English for, красите. Painter molecules. The molecules of paint, substances that are used for paint.
Yes. Holliman.
Molecules. There is large macromolecules, and they exist in quantum states. They have a structure of Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen pairs. But the components of these pairs is also large macroscopic states. And all of these exist in at the room temperature and even at higher temperature in liquid and in solid states. Therefore, the idea that large macroscopic states really could exist in microtubules or in other organelles in neurons is not so strange, because we really have examples of such quantum states.
Сознание бессмертного противника. So it's a question from journal Огонек, popular journal. And the question is the following. If quantum theory is correct, what does this imply for understanding of human? And whether it's implying that consciousness is immortal? Пожалуйста, выключите ради бога мобильный телефон.
The question is phrased, if quantum mechanics is correct, then so and so. But then if quantum mechanics is not correct, then I don't have to go any further. So I regard quantum mechanics as not being completely accurate.
Значит, поскольку вопрос так сформулирован, что если квантовая теория верна, то вот что-то такое следует, да, следует ли, то, значит, ответ профессора Перноса в том, что он считает, что квантовая теория неверна. И, следовательно, бессмысленно ответ. Да, так что, давайте я тогда быстро.
Если взгляды профессора Роу, вопрос был такой, что если ваши взгляды на природу сознания верны, то что это означает для человечества? Можно все выразить таким образом. Не обязательно просто. Вот те, которые профессор Петров предлагает. Что это означает для человека?
The next question of Aganyok is why do you think that physics, namely physics, can understand everything? And how this view is consistent with that, another view that the 21st century is called the century of biology?
Say the quest that physics controls everything does not mean that you understand everything in terms of physics, because there are many things which are so far away from the physical foundations that it's unreasonable to talk about them in terms of physics. So that if one talks about human behavior or chemistry, well, chemistry is more or less coming under physics, but biology is a long way from something which could be addressed usefully simply in terms of physics. So I think.
Да, профессор не считает, что физика объясняет все, что скорее, что физика является основанием. But do you mean that physics is foundation of natural science?
Yes, well, it's what you might say mathematics too, because physics depends on mathematics. But biology depends on physics. You wouldn't have a biological system, or you say human athletes, a human athlete has to be available to physics. So there is no suggestion that because a human athlete has a consciousness and has biological structures, is not constrained also by the laws of physics. It may be that the laws of physics are very limited in addressing what that athlete could do in practice, but it doesn't mean that the control of what behavior of that athlete is controls ultimately by physics.
Профессор Пенроуз говорит, что действительно, да, что действительно, да, математика и физика являются основанием естественных наук, но это не значит, что именно в терминах там, математики и физики возможно объяснить любые феномены, включая биологические. Но биология, например, зависит неким образом от физики.
That's physics, including the physics we don't know yet. So it's not the physics that we do know is not sufficient.
И кроме того, он все время подчеркивает, что он говорит о физике, которую мы еще не знаем. Поскольку физика, которую мы уже знаем, явно недостаточно.
Можно добавить? Ну, вопрос Петрова, наверное, относится к тому, что кажется, что здесь вот когда мы говорим там, о квантовом сознании, что физика вторгается не на свою территорию. Но на это можно ответить, что физика вторгается потому, что, так сказать, на той территории те науки, которые там всегда работали, не смогли ответить на вопрос.
Да, или не могут.
Вот на этот счет.
Можешь перевести, я забыл.
Сейчас я чуть-чуть добавлю.
Professor Mansky just makes a point that there is this argument that when physics speaks about consciousness, for example, it just goes beyond its proper limits, its proper territory. But Mikhail's point is that exactly because other sciences couldn't solve the problem themselves, so that, this is the reason why physics gets involved.
And the second illustration of the same thing. David которого сегодня уже упоминали, австралийский философ, говорил вот близко к тексту, хотя точно не скажу, сознание есть огромная тайна. И квантовая механика – таинственная наука. Так почему бы не думать, что они имеют общие источники? Эти две тайны.
Now we have this for Chalmers, that one theory is a big mystery and consciousness is a mystery. Why not yet? Those who need to be at this
level.
Okay. Давайте еще я один вопрос вот тоже с бумажки прочитаю в начале лекции. Зачем Роджеру нужен мир Платона, упомянутый в его книгах? Законы мира отражаются в человеческом сознании, в том числе в виде потенциальных закономерностей и так далее. So the question is, why do you need Platonic world mentioned in your book? For laws of world are reflected in human consciousness. So assumedly that does not require Platonic world.
I think the arguments are a bit separate. I mean, to take a view that, that mathematics has an existence independent of ourselves is a separate topic, but I'm prepared to discuss it. I mean, I certainly regard mathematics, well, there may be some boundaries which are not well understood because there are things that, which people might argue about, but mathematics is something external to ourselves. And one of the reasons for saying this, I mean, apart from the usual ones, is that the laws of physics are basically mathematical laws. Mm-hmm. And if mathematics was our creation somehow, how could those laws have existed a long time before there were human beings? Certainly, the laws of physics don't seem to have undergone some extraordinary change just at the time human consciousness arises. So there must be some mathematics for that physics to obey, which is independent of ourselves.
Нужно переводить его?
Обязательно.
Ответ Роджера состоит в том, что, ну, собственно, это немножко более специфический взгляд касается математики. Значит, его тезис состоит в том, что математические объекты существуют независимо от человеческого сознания. И то, что он приводит как аргумент, это тот факт, что законы физики вот, имеют математическое выражение. И, соответственно, вот только это можно объяснить тем, что... But Mellor was just asking further on the same point. But what about kind of Kantian explanation? Because Kant dealt with exactly the same problem and he has an account of saying both mathematics is somehow human and explain why it's just quite close.
Well, I try to express my view in the picture, which I have used several times, where you see three worlds. I mean, just schematically, one has the world of mathematics, which I regard as having existence in a certain sense. It's not the same as physical existence, and it's not the same as conscious experience. It's a different thing. And to say that the laws of physics are mathematical laws is to say that there is some, well, like in the picture, you have a part of the mathematics. I'm not saying all mathematics is reflected in physics, but some of it is reflected very, very precisely in physics. And I'm not saying that all of physics is conscious. There are some aspects of conscious which activate us in some way, our conscious experiences. And I'm not saying that all our conscious experience is mathematics. I think most people would agree with that. But some of our conscious experience is able to access the mathematical world. So I don't like to think of any one of them as prior, if you like. We have each one has its impact on the next one.
Я просто спросил, а почему нельзя вот такое кантианское объяснение применить, да, что не верить в платоновские миры, и объяснить, почему законы физики являются математическими. И Роджер ответил, что вот он свою эту картинку из трех миров вспомнил, и что они как бы частично пересекаются. Вот он сейчас нам написал, то есть не вся математика, так сказать, участвует в физике, не вся физика участвует в сознании, и не все сознание — это математическое сознание. То есть вот есть как бы три мира, это правда, физика. So three roles are physics, mathematics,
conscious, whatever it is, consciousness is something which comes out of the physical world and the physical laws, and then also that we have access to mathematics through pure thought, if you like. So it has this kind of Platonic view that we have a window into that world which is accessible by consciousness.
Это уже говорит, что вот есть эти три мира, сознание, физика и математика, которые, так сказать, вот друг с другом связаны. И вот это, в этом, так сказать, смысл вот этого его платонизма, да, что у нас как бы есть наше сознание, вот как бы имеет такие окна в физику и в математику, ну и, соответственно, вот в это пересечение физики и математики. Так, давайте по поводу вопросов, давайте сейчас какой-то порядок тогда составим. Вот тот.
Подождите,
я спрошу,
говорите,
потом микрофон,
потому
что иначе там.
Ну
окей. Давайте.
Андрей.
Сейчас, подождите.
Ну, меня запиши, пожалуйста.
Так, подождите, давайте порядок сейчас. Вопрос.
You need to decide how many questions are in the car.
Так, еще ваш как вас зовут?
Сейчас,
иначе у нас просто не будет разговора. Так, здравствуйте, как? Александр?
До меня не дойдет.
Так, хорошо. Тамара? Тамара будет.
You're going to have to make a cut.
Так, и просить, как вас зовут?
Леонид Григорьевич.
Так, ну давайте пока у нас 7 вопросов. Как вас зовут?
Последний.
Юрий.
Окей. Вот мой вопрос.
Так, подождите, пока давайте вот будет у нас 8 и дальше посмотрим.
Скажите, а записки там передавали? Что
ну, записки я не все, у меня нет возможности. Я часть из них прочитал, иначе.
Вам даже такие же вопросы.
Понятно, ну вот именно, ну кто-то ответил, кто-то нет. Ну видите, иначе мы просто. Никого из зала не сможет пригласить.
Так, я так сказала, после записки
передала. Нужно дверь закрыть, да? Мы закрыли окна. Не надо закрывать дверь, там есть
воздух. Окей, пожалуйста, профессор Фитов, пожалуйста,
вопрос. Я задам вопрос по-русски, а мой, нет, вот мой коллега готов любезно перевести. I'm sorry, my English is very poor. Значит, мой вопрос стоит в следующем. Известна теорема Гёделя о неполноте формальной арифметики. В связи с этой теоремой разные авторы, и в том числе и уважаемый профессор Пенроуз, говорят о ограниченности человеческого мышления, которое возникает в связи с теоремой Гёделя о неполноте. Однако, имеет место следующий результат, к сожалению, малоизвестный. Результат Кузнецова-Драгалина. Если к формальной арифметике добавить правило бесконечной индукции Карнапа, то формальная арифметика становится полной. То есть теорема Гёделя о неполноте для такого варианта арифметики не имеет места. Отсюда вопрос. А не кажется ли естественным считать, что теорема Гёделя о неполноте, как и теорема о полноте формальной арифметики с правилом бесконечной индукции, не имеет отношения к миру ментальных состояний, не говорят об ограниченности человеческого мышления, а относятся к сфере теории исчислений и, соответственно, к миру три объективного содержания мышления по Карлу Поппе. Мой вопрос стоит в следующем. Согласен ли с таким утверждением, уважаемый профессор?
Давайте нам перевестите
как-то. Don't you want to translate?
Theory about incompleteness of formal arithmetic
is usually discussed in connection with the problem of limits of human thinking, human knowledge, as, for example, in your book. But there exists a theory proved by two Russian logicians, Kuznetsov and Dragayev, according to which formal arithmetic with Carnap's rule of Emsen's induction is full.
Complete.
This is against it.
This rule of infinite induction of Carnap.
Professor Finn thinks that it follows from this result that Gödel's theory, as the theory of Kuznetsov and Dragayev, has relation to the theory of Karpin, but not to the world of mental states. To Popper's work 3 of objective content of knowledge, and not to his world 2, world of mental states and processes. Do you agree with this?
I'm not familiar with what you're saying. I'm not quite sure what the theorem is you're referring to.
Maybe we can explain, try to explain that. Okay. So colleagues refer to theorem, I don't know actually that result either, but they say that with the if you add to Piano arithmetic another principle, which is this Carnap induction, I don't know what it is, but then arithmetic becomes complete. And so they doubt that Gödel's theorem has anything to do with mental states or human knowledge. They say it's just rather, this other theorem shows that Gödel's theorem is just a technical result, which is about logic and nothing about consciousness. Anything of that sort.
I don't think that can have any direct relevance in the arguments I use. I mean, there are ways of complete. I mean, you know, there's Gensen's procedure and so on. I mean, there are ways of going beyond the standard. I mean, that's not the point. See, the way I phrase the argument is in terms of computation. Mm-hmm. So it's the Turing form. Mm-hmm. So you say that whatever procedures we use in our understanding. Let me put it in words a little more directly. If you have any, I'm just concerned with a very limited type of mathematical statement, namely what's called a pi 1 sentence. Mm-hmm. So it says a certain, this kind of statement I'm referring to is a statement of the following form. Such and such a computation never terminates. So it's saying a certain Turing machine action never stops. And so how do you prove statements of that sort? Now if you can prove such statements by means of a computationally checkable system of rules, which you trust, so if you believe that those rules necessarily only give you truths about this kind of statement, then you must be, you can see that there are statements of this very same kind which these rules do not access, but nevertheless, which your belief in the rules, your trust in the rules extends also to those statements. So you're saying that those statements, if you like, the Gödel sentence, it is a Gödel sentence, the Gödel sentence is true, and we can see that it's true by the same belief system that tells us those rules are to be trusted. So if those rules are to be trusted, if you believe the rules are any good anyway, then you can see how to transcend those rules. And I don't see how this statement, right, whatever it is,
so I'll try to translate it now.
Yeah. Okay.
Смотрите, нет, вот профессор Петров говорит, что ну очень хорошо, но это как бы не рушит его аргумента. Смотрите, ну я сейчас объясню, почему так я понял. Значит, утверждение следующее. Он говорит, смотрите, собственно говоря, здесь дело вот не столько делать, сколько вычислений. Вот у нас есть какое-то исчисление, правило вывода. И мы как-то должны верить, ну почему-то, что они правильные. Да? Окей, мы верим, что они правильные. И дальше мы с помощью вот этих же принципов, согласно которым мы считаем эти правила правильными, ну или какие-то близкие вещи, сейчас это было, мы доказываем всякие такие мета-теоремы. Ну, что, например, у нас там никогда не остановится какой-то алгоритм. Понимаете? Но этими же опять правилами мы доказываем, что мы не можем это вывести. И то есть, ну, утверждение его в чем? Что то, что мы делаем в математике, оно как бы выходит вот за вычисление, что это больше, чем вычисление. И в этом смысле вот этот результат, хорошо, там добавили еще одну аксиому, все получилось полнота, но как бы мы не, собственно, проблема, я так понимаю.
Нет, нет, нет. Все гораздо более просто и более ясно. А, теорема Гёделя не полноте формальной арифметики. Теорема Гёделя не полноте формальной арифметики. Огромное количество популяризаторов распространяется на тему, что из-за того, что существуют истинные утверждения, которые недоказуемы, человеческое мышление ограничено.
Наоборот. Нет,
говорит там...
противоположно.
Нет, именно это в книжке и я и вычитал. Там сказано как раз и именно говорится о том, что теорема Гёделя о неполноте говорит о ограниченных возможности человеческого мышления, ментальных состояний. Так как не наоборот? А что наоборот?
Он говорит наоборот.
Наоборот.
Мышление человеческое, да. Оно как бы
выходит за рамки.
Причем так не про то я говорю. Нет, нет, совершенно другая история. Что теорема Гёделя о неполноте относится к миру 3 по Попперу, к миру объективного содержания мышления. К мышлению отношения не имеют, и к искусственному интеллекту отношения не имеют. А, нет, вот я не получил ответ. Аргумент такой, добавили правила бесконечной индукции Карнапа к формальной арифметике, и все становится полным. Следовательно, это сфера человеческого знания, но не мышления. Поэтому говорить о теореме Гёделя в связи с искусственным интеллектом бессмысленно. Вот мы и утвердили. Но просто когда говорят люди про искусственный интеллект, не следует говорить про теорему Гёделя. Вот и все.
И в этой книжке...
Okay, the point is that Professor Finn expresses the fact that many people say, but perhaps it's not you, and so we have this question, that Gödel's theorem shows that human thinking is bounded, something like that, right?
No.
No, that's not true.
That's not funny.
Unbounded. Я думаю, что это аргумент не совсем правильный. Потому что рассуждение об искусственном интеллекте опирается не на теорему Гёделя в формальной арифметике, а на теорему Гёделя-Тьюринга в машинах Тьюринга, немножко другого. Машина Тьюринга имеет фиксированную структуру.
Не надо понимать, что вы не понимаете. Окей, Александр stresses the point that actually Roger's argument is based on, conversion of Gödel argument, which is directly relevant to Turing machine.
Это не совсем то же самое, что исходы теоремы Гёделя, и совсем не имеет отношения к арифметике, расширенной вот этим вот принципом индукции
Карнапа. Yeah, and so it has nothing to do with the arithmetic extended by Карнапа.
It's in accordance with that. Sorry. I don't say it's in accordance with that. I'll show you how you can. If you think you've come to the end, no, you haven't. You can see how to go beyond it. Yeah. We probably not disagree.
Okay, давайте другие. Кто здесь? Липкович. Да, пожалуйста.
Здесь хорошо, что затронули этот вопрос математики и физики, но дело в том, что математическая модель, которую мы немножко разработали, она касается именно возможности человеческого сознания, ну, скажем, предугадывать те события, которые будут. То есть мы разработали систему, модель, которая прогнозирует с вероятностью 96%, те события, которые происходят. для человечества, понимаете? Пришельцы, например, процесс аварии, пожары, можете перевести, там, убийства и так далее. Вопрос в том, есть ли возможность человеку это предугадать? Вот Кейси, он, между прочим, говорил во сне, а мы можем это предугадать. Мы рядом мире. И есть модель, мы можем показать. Даже показать можно.
Actually, gentlemen just claimed that they created a mathematical model that repeats any event. Like the battery, they had a mathematical model that allows to predict events.
Just predict
things.
What's the
point? Так, давайте, давайте Тамара нам
Профессор Пенроуз, спасибо вам большое за ваше выступление. Спасибо вам огромное. Вот, мой вопрос заключается, я задам как бы два вопроса в одном. Первый вопрос заключается в том, вы как ученый, ответьте, пожалуйста, какое место занимает философия в образовании ученого, то есть математика, биолога, физика?
В образовании или
в образовании подготовки и в исследованиях, естественно.
So Tamara has two questions. The first question is, what do you think about the place of philosophy in education, in scientific education, and in scientific research?
Yes. Well, we had a discussion on this question in the Oxford Union quite recently, I think my position here was that philosophy is very important to me anyway in thinking about physics, but I'm never quite sure how useful I find philosophers. So it's I think many scientists, even the ones who perhaps don't think, I mean, Feynman made some very negative comments about philosophy. But I suspect he was making negative comments about maybe certain philosophers rather than philosophy. I mean, I think that that it's very important to think about issues which, to me, are philosophical. I'm not sure whether philosophers think of them as philosophical, because they are, it's a little borderline whether they're really physics or philosophy. But I think thinking about philosophical issues is very important. Whether much of philosophical discussion is something which I can't get into. I find it very difficult to understand. So I don't often find specific commentaries that philosophers make useful to my own thinking, but largely because they are directed at other philosophers, and I haven't read the other philosophers either, so I don't know exactly what the issues are.
Да, Роджер сказал, они как раз недавно обсуждали этот вопрос в Оксфордском собрании. И к такому пришли методы. Роджер считает, что, безусловно, философия очень важна и для образования, и для науки, собственно, в его собственной работе, и проблемы возникают не столько с философией, сколько с философами иногда. И вот, наверное, всякие отрицательные такие комментарии, например, Файнмана, их тоже надо относить, наверное, не столько к философии, сколько к философам. И проблема здесь может быть вот в чем, он говорит. Но мне очень интересны всякие философские вопросы, но я вот не знаю, философы будут считать их философскими. Для меня, говорит, они философские. И когда, говорит, начинают читать философию, там философ что-то такое пишет и говорит какому-то другому философу. Но тогда я должен прочитать другого философа. И поэтому, ну, я бы так это резюмирую. May I say it is just a problem, say, of communication between scientists and philosophers?
Yes. There was another point that came up in this discussion, which I was commenting. Since there, I was commenting on the philosophers in Oxford to some degree, because I consider them to be very well educated and very thoughtful about quantum mechanics. That probably, as a group of philosophers, they know more quantum mechanics than any group of philosophers I know. However, it seems to me that they miss a trick, because one of the most fundamental questions
in physics is a very philosophical question. That is the ontology of quantum mechanics. And it seems to me that you know, they should say, okay, there's something funny, something not quite right about quantum mechanics, because it has no sensible ontology. Now, that's a good job for a philosopher, but they don't do it, you see. They say, oh, well, you know, they go around in circles and try to make sense of the theory as it is, rather than pointing out to the physicists, no, you must do something about this.
Но он говорит, у меня как раз вот тоже разговаривали с философами, и, например, он считает, вот такая задачка для философов, придумать какую-нибудь онтологию для квантовой механики. Говорит, вот проблема в том, что мы не можем понять, что там происходит. И вот с его точки зрения философы чем-то таким должны были бы заниматься, но у них в Оксфорде они не занимаются. Но я, между прочим, от себя хочу сказать, что вот в этой стране, мне кажется, традиция связи философии и физики гораздо больше, чем в Оксфорде. Но, на самом деле. Окей, да, и второй вопрос.
Ну, вы сказали по поводу того, что существует много разных философов, но второй вопрос заключается в том, что роль ученого, роль науки сегодня в современном обществе достаточно ясна. А вот что вы лично вы скажете по поводу роли фигуры философа в современном мире? Ведь мы живем в очень сложном мире и трудном для понимания, для жизни. А вот вы как человек, который занимается теорией сложности, пожалуйста, можете ответить.
Yeah. Actually, second question is closely related. Is Tamara asks, what you think about the role, say, of scientists in society, and maybe also role of
philosophy? Well, yes, it's a difficult one. No, I think that. There is an important role, clearly, of scientists in society. Let's talk about scientists first. I mean, there are important things like, of course, global warming, where scientists have something to say, which is very important for humanity. And there is always the problem that scientists are constrained to say things in a very cautious way and not overstate a case. Whereas people who are not scientists seem to be able to say things in much more extreme ways without justification. So I think that, I think the scientific point of view is very...
Ну, Роджер говорит, сначала я просто спросил вот роль ученого, роль философа все-таки отдельно. Говорит, по роли ученого, ну, например, какие-то важные, типа там, глобального потепления, да, говорит, ученые, в отличие от людей, которые какие-то экстремальные взгляды, такие, либо есть, либо завтра, либо нет, но ученые вот могут какие-то здесь более, так сказать, квалифицированные, спокойные эксперты оценку.
Just let me just say generally, I think there should be more both influence of philosophical discussion and scientific discussion better understood in the general public than there is in the
world. Вот он считает, что как раз очень важная роль философии, чтобы, как бы сказать, она вместе с наукой работала, так сказать, в обществе. Что это
было...
Что как раз, ну, так сказать, хорошая модель вот, взаимодействия науки и философии с обществом, когда они работают вместе. Да, то есть именно, так сказать, философия вместе с наукой может быть более эффективной вот, в публичной дискуссии. Так, следующий у нас Александров, пожалуйста.
Если позволите, тоже два вопроса. Один короткий, другой чуть-чуть менее короткий.
По очереди.
Первый вопрос. Вы много говорили о будущем физики, о том, что только будущая физика может решить эту фундаментальную проблему. Правильно ли я понимаю, что вы считаете программу Суперструн, программу Струн паллиативным и недостаточным решением для этой проблемы фундаментальной?
Yeah, first question is concerns the future of physics. And actually, whether what you say about the future of physics implies that the string theory program is not sufficient.
Well, I think the string theory program is a good illustration of
where in the absence of experimental results, people get carried away by mathematical ideas, which are interesting in themselves, often very powerful ideas, but no indication whatsoever that they are deeply related to what goes on in the physical world. So I think string theory one trouble is it's probably more in the general public. The general public think, oh, well, string theory, because they've been told that this is the major direction in which basic physics is going, without knowing anything about it, really. Whereas I think even the string theorists these days do not think that their string theory, as it exists at the moment, shows much promise of being the real direction in which physics should go. So I think that's a good example of physics which is done for its mathematical content, rather than having much chance of being directly relevant to the physical world. Although it may be. The main problem I have with it, did you want to say that and I can mention my trouble? Mm-hmm. The main problem I have with it is the extra dimensions. The trouble with string theory is not the strings, it is the higher dimensions. And I think that there is very little chance that a theory in which there are many extra space dimensions, that a theory of that nature can be correct. But there could be a theory which involves strings at a fundamental level, but without the extra dimensions. But they can't do that, so.
Ответ состоит в том, что, согласно Роджеру, теория струн как раз такой хороший пример теории, которая, как сказать, так и претендует на то, чтобы быть физической теорией, но имеет, так сказать, много математического содержания и на сегодняшний день практически не имеет физического содержания. Он говорит о том, что не исключено, что какая-то, по крайней мере, часть этой теории может быть использовано в будущей физике, но Роджер особенно скептически относится к вот, лишним измерениям пространственным. То есть, говорит, ничего такого быть не может. Сейчас второй вопрос.
Сначала спасибо за ответ. На первый, я тоже думаю, что в теории струн нет глубоких идей, и это причина проблемы. А второй вопрос. Может быть, даже не только к нашему гостю, а к остальным тоже. Это вопрос о стыке философии и физики. Долгое время, естественно, наука развивалась в такую сторону, что мышление ученых становилось более материалистическим. В какой-то момент после появления квантовой механики возникло ощущение, что тенденция поменялась. Вот как думает наш гость, возможно, кто-то еще хотел бы ответить, вот та физика будущего, которая имеется в виду, будет ли она более идеалистической в таком смысле? Или наука так сильно продвинет свою границу, что для идеализма не останется никакого места.
So the next question is, yeah, the gentleman says that the past development of physics, of science generally, went, how say, there was a tendency, I just quote, that science becomes more materialistic. And then with quantum mechanics, it became somehow idealistic. And what do you think about future physics?
Well, that's a difficult question. I think that one trouble with quantum mechanics is it's not finished. And that people make philosophical pronouncements about quantum theory on the basis of a theory which is, as Einstein said, incomplete. And I would even make a stronger statement that it's self-inconsistent. So that you have to adopt some strange, not very clear-cut philosophical stance in order to make sense of the theory. But I regard that as a temporary situation. That someday, I hope at least, there will be a coherent theory. Now, there will be a coherent theory which doesn't suffer from the interpretational problems that quantum mechanics does. However, as a sort of caveat to that, I do take the view that these deeper issues that have been discussing here about consciousness do have a relation to where quantum mechanics must be going later. But that's a long gap.
Взгляд Роджера состоит в том, что квантовая механика вообще не полна. И то есть вот, вот в этом вся проблема, и, так сказать, поэтому там много интерпретаций. И он надеется, что, так сказать, вот будет будущая теория, которая, так сказать, избежит этой проблемы. И вот он считает, что как раз то, что вот эта связь квантовой механики темы с сознанием, это на самом деле такое указание на неполноту. И если мы об этом думаем, как раз мы, может быть, поймем, как, так сказать, какие-то увидим новые вещи.
Я спрашиваю, а будущее, если вы для того эмпиристически или эмпиристически,
не оказывается, я спрашиваю? Ну, так это идет именно, была речь о будущей физике, Троцер же имел в виду будущую квантовую механику. Так, еще, простите, Михаил, подождите, мы выделим будущую
ситуацию. Вопрос очень интересный. И вот в моей работе над квантовой концепцией сознания он встречался постоянно. И на разных стадиях этой работы ответы были немножко разные. Вот я скажу, что я думаю сейчас. Во-первых, когда говорят, что физика становится более идеалистической, то есть стала проявлением квантовой механики, то на самом деле точная формулировка должна быть другой. Что физика перестала укладываться в рамки вульгарного материализма. А вот, значит, на какой-то стадии я понял, что вот теория сознания и суперсознание, и сверхсознание, она соединяет то, что обычно относится к материальной сфере, к сфере материи, к сфере духа. Соединяет. А еще более с общей точки зрения я могу сказать так, хотя это отчасти надежда на будущее, что не вульгарный, а настоящий материализм на самом деле может включить все вот это, абсолютно. То есть ничего, не останется ничего такого, что мы вынуждены будем считать идеалистическим. В рамки серьезного материализма укладывается все, что есть в природе. Если мы правильно ее отражаем, это будет материализм.
Михаил, just remark that okay, at a certain point science ceases to be compatible with the vulgar materialism, and actually his hope is that some sophisticated materialism, true materialism, would cover everything.
Yeah. Yes, what we understand by materialism is very well, old-fashioned, if you like. Physics has moved on from that, and will move further.
Говорит тоже Роджер Домитрий, что то, что мы часто понимаем под материализм, это слишком старомодное, поэтому нам нужно вот, согласен с Михаилом, что нам нужен какой-то новый, такой серьезный материализм.
Здесь
вопрос.
Очень короткое замечание. Современные эксперименты наиболее фундаментальных в областях физики становятся все более дорогими. Требует все больше времени для реализации. И поэтому вот независимо от идеализма и материализма можно прогнозировать, что, конечно, в будущей физике будет расти роль самосогласованности и красоты теории по сравнению с экспериментом. И связано это именно с усложнением эксперимента.
Александр remarks, let's say very controversial, that exactly because experiments become so expensive. So physics is going to develop more to kind of pure theory, and so criteria like YouTube will play more role. What do you think?
Well, that's an interesting point. Maybe, but I think the trouble is that people use beauty a little bit too freely, and they, you know, the originator of some theory will remark on its beauty. But some other person coming across the same theory may not have the same view about it. So one has to be very careful about the use of aesthetics. I'm sure it is an important factor, but it has to be used very carefully and not as the real reason for believing in your theory.
Так. Роджер замечает, что красота все-таки такая вещь субъективная в том смысле, что кому-то это может что-то нравится, кому-то нет. И поэтому вот он считает, что хотя он согласен, что красота теории, это, так сказать, играет свою роль, но не надо эту роль преувеличивать, и надо, так сказать, осторожно к ней относиться. Хорошо, спасибо. Так, давайте у нас по списку дальше Ксения. Да. Давайте, если можно, по одному только вопросу, потому что мы начинаем торопиться.
Спасибо большое за разговор. Я хотела спросить, что если наука о сознании может быть основана на физике будущего, то есть на квантовой теории гравитации, то в чем видится основание самой будущей этой теории? И в частности, более конкретно, требуется ли для этого другая математика? Возможно ли ее основать на совершенно другой математике? Ну, например, допустим, на дробном исчислении? Такой вопрос.
Подожди, еще раз. Какая нужна математика для новой физики?
Может, фрактальная.
Ну, фрактальная.
Actually, the question was a very interesting question. So you say this physics is not sufficient to understand the brain and we need new physics, but Ksenia asked that we have also what kind of mathematics we need for new physics?
Well, according to the proposal that I'm making, it will have to involve mathematics of a non-computational character. Now, there's nothing wrong with that as mathematics, because we know that there are many areas of mathematics which are not computational. But it would be interesting to see that kind of mathematics actually being employed in physics, which would be something quite new, because physics as we know it is pretty well basically computational. There is the caveat there that it's computational even though one is using continuous parameters all the time. And you have to be a little bit careful by what you mean by that. And there may be deep issues there too. But I suspect we need something quite different. So it would be extremely interesting to see what kind of mathematics could come in to give you a valid description of whatever this new physics is. It's a very interesting question.
Прежде всего, вот эта новая физика, новая математика, она скорее должна быть невычислимая, это невычислительная. И в этом смысле, хотя предыдущая физика не везде, это не всегда работает, да, надо с осторожными какими-то оговорками только это утверждать, но как бы, в общем, в каком-то приближении ее можно назвать вычислительной или вычислимой, я не знаю, computational. И вот это новое здесь как раз вот пойдет за счет чего-то невычислимое. Так, давайте, знаете, еще наверное, два. Да, давайте. Да, я думаю, что, пожалуйста, последний вопрос, извините. Да.
Я могу и без микрофона.
Нет, никто не услышит.
У меня такой конкретный физико-математический вопрос. Я познакомился с методикой полного решения уравнения Дирака. Автор восстановил два состояния движения, два спинора, которые он назвал Зиг и Заг, что помешало автору отождествить эти два состояния, Зиг и Заг, с досветовой и сверхсветовой скоростями движения электрона. Тем более, что в одном случае...
Можно я, чтобы переводить, я не понимаю, это вы пересказываете работу Роджера?
Да. Зиг и Заг. Да, это из книги «Путь к реальности» или «Законы, которые управляют Вселенной», или «О законах».
Значит, еще раз, можете сказать, значит, вы спрашиваете, да. То есть ваша идея в том, что вот эти Зиг и Заг надо отождествить?
Почему, да, что их надо отождествить с досветовой и сверхсветовой скоростями движения, тем более, что речь идет в одном случае о вещественном времени, а в другом о мнимом. А что помешало автору сделать такое отождествление? Или мой вопрос относится к тому, что к невежественному постановке?
Я должен перевести. Давайте,
короче.
Нет, question concerns, actually, your move around to reality and place where you're talking about two spinners. Zig and Zag. And actually...
до световой.
Yeah, there is a suggestion to identify them with pre-light and overlight speed. That's right.
No. You could think of them as both the speed of light. If they go the speed of light this way, speed of light that way. There's never either less or more. Always the speed of light.
Нет. Давайте решить самый последний вопрос, все мы скажем.
Дежавик Борисович, мой вопрос значительно проще. Конечно же.
Давайте только
конечно же. И такие конструкции, как пространство, линейный континуум. Тем более, Гильбертово пространство квантовой механики – это уже далеко не вульгарный материализм. С этим я согласен. Но достаточно ли оснований для того, чтобы пытаться поместить сознание либо в континуум Минковского, либо в волновую функцию квантовой механики? Или же основания здесь такие, как у человека, который ищет потерянный кошелек под фонарем, просто потому, что там светло?
Я не очень понял
сейчас. По слогам давайте.
Не, ну нет, еще раз.
Пожалуйста. Значит, физика дала новые нетривиальные конструкции мира, не сводимые к вульгарным материализмам. Но достаточно ли этих конструкций, таких как...
Могу быть, что нет.
Подождите, ну переведите.
А, ну все, давайте.
Континуум Минковского и так далее. Или же здесь поиск кошелька под фонарем.
I think that was asking, okay, physics just gave us quantum mechanics, gave us relativity, and now we are trying to explain brain with that, and so his question is whether it works, and I think your question is, it doesn't work.
Yes. I'm saying that we need more than quantum mechanics and relativity separately. We need something in which there is a change not only in our picture of space-time, but also in our way of quantum mechanics. The current quantum mechanics is an approximation.
Значит, Роджер говорит, что нам нужно не только недостаточно, прежде всего, ответ отрицательный, что недостаточно теории относительности квантовой механики, чтобы объяснить сознание, там высшую нервную деятельность, и нужно как бы изменить и то, и другое, и создать какую-то общую теорию.
Можно последний вопрос?
Давайте потом же в кулуар. Давайте поблагодарим. Кто хочет послушать профессора Пенройса, вот буквально скоро в 19:30 в Политехническом музее будет публичная лекция с русским переводом. То есть у нас тут вот да, тема лекции. Да, скажите.
Вот. Тема лекции. It's not on, Галина. The microphone, it's not on.
It is on.
Is it? Okay, hold it close to your mouth.
Тема лекции «Круги времени. Можно ли сквозь большой взрыв предвидеть предыдущую вселенную?» Политехнический музей сегодня в 19:30.
Вход свободный.
Вход свободный.
Какая аудитория подъезд?
Большая аудитория политехнического музея.
А кто будет читать?
Девятый подъезд.
Девятый подъезд.
Девятый подъезд.